Hello, traders. It's Thursday, December the 1st. This is John Kicklider, Chief Strategist for DailyFX.com. Here to give you a market wrap-up for the past 24 hours of trade, as well as an outlook for what we can expect in the next 24. Actually, we'll have to probably go out 48 hours to start off this new trading month. Well, the biggest move on this past session, and it was loaded with event risk, but I think the scale of the moves can sort them out and sort these assets out for themselves, would come from oil. We laid out the general scenarios for how oil can be motivated, bullish, bearish, depending on the outcome of that important OPEC meeting, and we weren't disappointed in terms of short-term volatility. This is a move of incredible scale. In fact, you can see here, this was a 9% plus advance. That is the biggest rally from U.S. oil WTI crude that we've seen since February 22nd, which back then was actually the start of a reversal or bull trend. That actually draws a lot of comparison, not necessarily just because of the scale of the move, but also because of the fundamental circumstance. In this case, it was a low. All right, it was a multi-year low on oil. The assumption was the supply glut had really captured the speculative pricing and was fully priced in at that point. And once again, we start to see jawboning coming around, threats by oil ministers to cut down on the production. Never really followed through at that point, but it gained a little bit more traction and pushed the markets higher. This time around, we're not at a low. All right, this is just a remarkable move on the point of gold, gold oil, because of the fundamental circumstances. That OPEC meeting resulted in an agreement to actually cut production from the entire group of over a million barrels per day. So in terms of the capacity or overcapacity that we have in oil, there is still a tremendous glut in the availability of the commodity out in the open market. It's going to take some time to work down. Also, non-OPEC members can decide to ignore their efforts and continue to fill in that gap. It's actually very likely. I don't know if they'll fill the entire gap, but they will fill some of that gap to gain market share. But it nevertheless shows cooperation, and it gives some tangibility to what has been otherwise speculation. This was the bullish outcome that we talked about in that somewhat binary or black and white assessment of this particular event. The market took it obviously as such because it did a 9% rally. We have yet to get to the critical levels on a technical basis. That is this big 52 level at the moment, which is range high going all the way back to or a year and some months. But this does not, or this outcome from this OPEC meeting does not necessarily secure that advance. We have to be skeptical because the follow-through here is dependent upon what the next stage is. Do we actually see a significant work down in supplies? The promise is in place, but is the actual action going to cover it? Remains to be seen. And this is a market that's grown very wary, certainly wary of promises and speculation as well. So keep an eye on this. Further drivers are definitely going to be oriented towards the supply-demand factors. Those inventory figures that we see on a weekly basis, probably going to have a more significant influence on day-to-day price action now. So do keep those in mind, too. Another big mover on the day, thanks to a cumulative positive outcome on data, is the U.S. dollar. Looking at the dollar's fundamental backdrop, we had ADP employment change, which was actually significantly better than expected. We also had an increase in income, though spending did contract from the previous month. And the PCE deflator actually essentially held out as is. We also had the Fed speech, which pretty much all of it's going to be hawkish at this point. Not rampant hawkish, but certainly hawkish. That collective view of a higher probability rate hike, obviously we're already pricing in fully the December rate hike, so there's nothing new there. But the interest now is in the subsequent policy meetings, February 1st, March 14th, and so on and so forth, does get a little bit of a boost. It's not enough of a boost to actually put us to new 13 plus year highs on the dollar index, but it did offset that pullback, which itself, looking at the dollar index, was the possible head and shoulders pattern that we can see on the 4-hour chart. All right. It hasn't broken the four hour pattern head and shoulders, but it certainly does put it in jeopardy. If we set a new high above 102 on the ICE dollar index, that would make it more of a range, more prone to continuation than a head and shoulders pattern. Follow through, however, if we were looking for it, it would be smart to find a counterpart which the dollar would do better against. I would be a little bit more skeptical of the dollar yen, but look at how remarkable that drive has been. The general positive performance of Richmond this past session, but more importantly, the strong dollar managed to extend this run. This didn't have a head and shoulders pattern on the 4 hour chart, but it was consolidatory. But we did have strong continuation here. Now we're getting back up towards levels that 116, that was the range low of a big head and shoulders pattern on this currency pair all the way back to actually the beginning of 2016, and that was a critical break that we saw. Is this going to be another point along the way of a rally, or is this going to hold up as more technical boundary or robust technical boundary that holds us off on our bullish ambitions? Remains to be seen, but that is a high profile tech level that we need to keep tabs on. I am dubious of this continuing through, but as long as risk trends remain steady, it can find that path. So if you're already a bull, keep an eye on this. If you're skeptical like me, look for confirmation before you take the plunge on a trade to trade a reversal. It's always risky trading reversals. There's a trend for a reason, and we need to see that reason drop and correct. The Euro USD is the same way. We did have a stress on that inverse head and shoulders pattern, but it hasn't broken. We're still on a right shoulder. The neckline still is about 106.50, and obviously most interest is actually on the bottom of this 2 year range. This has more potential to move back in the range, as I said before, simply because not necessarily anything to do with the dollar and its extended nature, although it is extended, but more so to do with the fact that it's easier to trade into a range than it is to break a major low and progress into a decade plus uncharted territory. So this is another place that I think the dollar would do better if it were to drop rather than rally. If you're looking for continuation, perhaps something like the dollar CAD. This past session, oil versus dollar, both strong, and they would neutralize each other, no trend development. Or Aussie USD, there is more range for the dollar to cover here. Maybe even dollar Kiwi dollar, which there has more range to cover. So I would look at some of these. Now, in the next 24 hours, the docket is going to ease up a little bit. We do have high-profile releases. We already had the Japanese third-quarter data, which was bad. We have the Chinese PMIs. We have the UK inflation figures, and also European PMIs. We will look at more Fed speak, and I think very important is the manufacturing ISM PMI from the U.S. But really, most of the interest is going to be rolling out to non-farm payrolls on Friday and the Italian referendum on the weekend. That's very high profile influence over the euro and the dollar. So keep an eye further out and expect these bigger picture fundamentals to have a huge influence. All right, so for now, keep a close eye on what's moving, but be skeptical about its ease of follow through. I'll give our next rundown of the markets tomorrow. Until then, I wish you good luck trading out there.